Billionaires should not exist. It's something that we need to say loudly and proudly, and if possible, put it on a bumper sticker, throw that on your car, because we need to get the word across that you cannot ever earn $1 billion. Anyone who earns, quote unquote, earns $1 billion, either exploited the labor of their workers or exploited tax laws or exploited our political system to get to that point. Now, I've said before that billionaires shouldn't exist, but moreover, they absolutely should not be able to buy elections and buy positions of power. We're seeing that more and more. You know, they'll contribute to the campaigns of politicians and get really cushy jobs. Betsy DeVos is a billionaire who donated to Donald Trump, and now she is Secretary of Education. Isn't that funny how that works? But now they're just becoming more brazen and they're financing their own elections. We have a president who did that, and now we have individuals like Mike Bloomberg who are trying to do the same thing. And he has spent millions upon millions of dollars, more than $50 million, I want to say, in the first week that he announced to just flood the airwaves. And he is relatively successful at getting his message out there, which is, you know, proven by the fact that he is polling at the mid-tier already. He's at above 5%, I think, passing Andrew Yang, someone who has been in this race for over a year. So billionaires shouldn't exist, and they shouldn't be able to run for president, because if you actually want to protect democracy, you've got to have some restrictions in place to protect democracy. Sort of like we shouldn't tolerate intolerance. We shouldn't, you know, be so democratic that we allow democracy to eat itself, right? So with that being said, I want to share an article that I found on Jacobin that I absolutely think is crucial. It's from Luke Savage, and he explains why, like Donald Trump, Mike Bloomberg is also a threat to democracy. He writes, from candidates openly courting billionaires at black tie fundraisers to campaigns that boast intimate ties with private equity and high finance, the immense influence of wealth can be seen everywhere. All it took was a few polls favorable to Bernie Sanders and a handful of headlines containing the words wealth tax to get Howard Schultz musing about mounting a spoiler campaign. Not one, but two billionaires have jumped into the race since the country's most gilded caffeine baron got cold feet, though the extent to which these efforts will translate into actual votes remain to be seen. Michael Bloomberg's campaign in particular has already become a powerful illustration of the way billionaires convert their wealth into power as a conscious strategy and the threat that it poses to democracy. To state the most obvious, Bloomberg has already poured in a whopping $58.4 million to carpet bomb several states with TV and radio advertising, outspending anyone else in the race by exponential margins. Fellow billionaire Tom Steyer isn't all that far behind. More subtle, though, no less insidious, is the way Bloomberg's past contributions to various campaigns and initiatives have enabled him to purchase political contacts and legitimacy the way a regular person buys groceries. Each and every one of Bloomberg's mayoral endorsers has several things in common. In addition to their roles as local elected officials, all have had him at one time or another as a benefactor, and all have attended his prestigious boot camp at Harvard that gives the mayors access to ongoing strategic advice from Bloomberg-funded experts. More than half have also received funding and grants courtesy of none other than Mike Incorporated. The problem isn't that such behavior secures wealthy individuals like Bloomberg direct benefit in the form of quid pro quo relationships, though it certainly can. It doesn't have to. When you're so rich, you have a couple billion dollars to throw around, you're no longer an individual making voluntary private contributions. Rather, you're a stakeholder in the basic infrastructure of politics and society itself. As the emerging dynamic in the Democratic presidential race makes all too clear, you can have billionaires or you can have democracy. And as long as you have the former, you can expect the latter to be perpetually compromised. Now, I think that this is an incredibly powerful argument against not only having billionaires, but allowing them to just be able to buy democracy, right? And the article goes into detail about the way that Mike Bloomberg has effectively bought goodwill and political capital, which is incredibly disturbing. I mean, he's spending money buying complicity from groups and individuals, which has allowed him to basically maintain the level of legitimacy that he has currently. And this includes charitable contributions, personal favors like paying for medical procedures and whatnot. And we touched on the mayoral endorsements he's received, and there's a total of 8. But that in and of itself, even though it's not a large number, it shows you how far his reach is, because this is someone who was the mayor of of one city, and mayors in other cities are suddenly endorsing him. I mean, isn't that interesting? I mean, we really should all be appalled at the fact that billionaires are trying to get elected by using the wealth that they have to buy goodwill, which in turn helps them cultivate political legitimacy. It's just, I mean, how are people not speaking out about this? How do people who claim to support democracy not feel uncomfortable about this? How does every single person not speak up? How does the media not do in-depth analyses about this? Now, the way that this article really portrays Bloomberg and the way he's used his money to do favors for a bunch of people, it really reminds me of, you know, the clientelism and patronage, these types of patron-client relationships that we see in the Middle East and North Africa. So in these really impoverished, usually resource-rich countries where, you know, elites have a lot of money and a lot of the population is desperate, basically there's these patron-client relationships where a public official will do a favor for you, and in exchange for said favor, they expect political support. They expect your vote. And oftentimes, you know, with these relationships, you can get in good with a public official if you bribe them. So, for example, if you need like a public document or a driver's license, that's not as easy as just going to the DMV and applying here. Not that that's easy in and of itself, but nonetheless, you know, if you want, for example, a driver's license in one of these countries in the MENA region, then you have to basically try to convince a public official to allow you to get one. You can bribe that individual, or maybe he'll give it to you, but that's a favor. So basically, the way that these relationships works is that, you know, it's give and take. You know, you give as much as you get, and that's kind of what I see happening, or what at least, you know, Luke Savage describes as happening with regard to Mike Bloomberg. He is buying goodwill, he's cultivating legitimacy by helping people and their personal political careers and personal lives. It is downright despicable. No one should support Mike Bloomberg. But people don't know any better. They see his ads, and a lot of the times, name recognition, it really plays a huge role, right? So people may not know better. They might just support him because, hey, that's the guy who I saw on TV. Now, sometimes it can backfire, right? Because we're seeing in the state of New Hampshire where Tom Steyer, another billionaire, has flooded the airwaves and his ads have become so, you know, annoying that they're basically a meme to people. They have them memorized there. So maybe it could backfire. But with Mike Bloomberg, it seems like his strategy is actually a little bit more successful. Now, whether or not he's going to be able to be somewhat victorious, you know, that remains to be seen, but the fact that he's polling nationally at above 5%, that should be just terrifying to everyone. Not because we think he'll win, but because look at what a billionaire can easily do. Spend money that is not that much money to them, and you can become a prominent presidential candidate. Wow.
You could support the Humanist Report at patreon.com/humanistreport. But trust me, I'd have way more supporters on Patreon if that was my podcast. Sad.